Fortnite Chapter 2 had a lot of change. It's not just talking about the map or tossing knocked opponents around with our teammates. With the new season also came some meta and playstyle changes we all need to get used to. And throughout the past week, we've noticed a few that a lot of players are having an especially hard time adjusting to. What's going on, guys? I'm Dan, and I'll be talking about the biggest mistakes we've been seeing players make in Chapter 2 so far. A lot of these errors are simple in nature. It's just that with how different things were in the last few seasons, it's surprisingly difficult for some to adapt. But don't worry, guys, we got you with the tips you need to start winning some more games. But before we get into it, if you guys are interested in getting better at Fortnite, then click the link below to go to ProGuides.com, where you can play with the best players in the world by just clicking a button. Sign up for our memberships at ProGuides, and you'll get a ton of incredible content from the best pro players like Benji and Mongrel. So if you want to compete in Fortnite, you have to check out ProGuides.com. Also, be sure to drop a like on this video to show your support. We strive to bring you the best content available. All right, with all that being said, let's get right into the video. Okay, let's get into it. Probably the most costly mistake we're seeing players make this season has to do with rotating. Mainly that they're not rotating early and not valuing the safe zone enough. It doesn't matter at which point of the game it is. Whether it's the early, mid, or late game, players are waiting for the last second to move way too often. Why is it a mistake? In the early games, you generally want to rotate early so you can avoid running into other players and starting storm fights. This has always been true, but with how much more mobility has been removed from the map and item pool, it's even truer this season. No more relying on the Loot Lake Rift to get us to the next zone for free. We've got to run, swim, or take a boat, so any time spent fighting while you should be moving can potentially hold you back. Taking a boat is fine if you need to rotate, but there's a risk associated with it. They're loud and noticeable, and you can easily get lasered while sitting in that driver's seat. Overall, the reward is usually worth the risk, but don't take a boat unless you've got a long way to go. They're not all that powerful like ballers or planes. Instead, you're a lot more vulnerable than you'd think. When it comes to using our feet to rotate, it seems as if most players have forgotten just how slow running is, and how easy it is to get caught up in the storm. Because we're still seeing so many players deciding to take mid-game fights with barely any time left on the clock, like when they still need to run across half the map. Even if they win the fight they take, they'll either die to the storm or take a ton of damage that's too hard to recover from. Because of that, you need to always consider the next zone's location before engaging in a fight. It's more crucial now than ever. Considering most arena points are given out during the late game, it's important to plan ahead so you can actually make it to that point. Speaking of late games, there are no more mobility items for us to use anymore. And so we're starting to see a lot of pro players and teams make their endgame rotations as soon as possible. Before, we could rely on mobility items like shockwave grenades or launch pads to take us towards zone last second. But now that we have to tunnel or run in the old-fashioned way, a quicker rotation will prevent you from falling behind and getting held in the storm. You can see it in this example here. Pro player Blue T and his squad move as soon as the circle is revealed. They're prioritizing positioning here because if they were to rotate any later, there would be even more teams set up, holding them in the storm. By moving early, they can be the ones that set up and pressure slower teams as they move in, and that's exactly what they do here. They get into zone and put enough pressure on the squad behind them to pick up a kill and some fantastic loot as a prize. A good rule of thumb is to begin moving before the zone starts closing in. Not in every single scenario exactly. Like if it was the first zone and it's halfway across the map, you might want to leave with an extra minute on the clock just to give yourself more time. But if you're looking to play for placements and get ahead of the pack, you should definitely be taking early rotations and avoid storm fighting. Do that and you'll make it to endgames more often. Another mistake a lot of players are making is still using Pump Shotty instead of the TAC. Don't get me wrong, the purple and gold ones are great with their fantastic one-shot potential, but the lower tier ones, gray to blue in rarity, don't have the same strength. The damage is pretty low, making them weaker than TAC shotguns in almost every scenario. So you would think that the pump would at least have better range damage than the TAC to compensate, but nope. A TAC Shotty will have higher damage at longer ranges, even when you compare a gray TAC to a blue pump. And with a lower rate of fire, there isn't much of a reason to use these weaker pumps once you find a TAC. The only thing the pumps have going for them is their pullout time, but it's just barely faster, and based on the numbers, it isn't a good enough reason to use one. Running attack also gives you a bit more flexibility when it comes to the rest of your loadout, mainly since you just keep the tac shoddy out and you don't need a weapon to swap after firing anymore. So you can end up only running a rifle and tac shoddy, then use the remaining 3 slots for either all healing items or a specialty weapon plus 2 heals, or even a rod so you can gather some fishies later on in the game. You don't have to get rid of an SMG from your loadout, but an extra slot for healing can make a huge difference when it comes to staying alive. To summarize this point, we're not saying that you shouldn't ever pick up the weaker pumps. A shotgun is always good to have in every loadout, and sometimes a gray pump is all you've got at the start of the game. But once you've found both weapons and you have a choice, pick the tac over the weaker pumps so you're not hindering yourself. Okay, so let's talk about how you can improve your early games. Now that we have a new map, so many mistakes are being made at the start of the match. What we've noticed is that too many players are ignoring unnamed locations and are still going for hot drops. Hot drops and named locations aren't bad or anything, but they may be causing you to die and lose games you could otherwise win. Here, let me explain. Every zone is new, apart from Pleasant Park, Retail Row, and Salty Springs. And unless you've been grinding for hours every day so far, most of us don't know the layouts of these places well enough to risk dropping with a ton of other players. Things like knowing the low points to get the fastest landing, or knowing which building has the most loot, these are still unknown factors to a lot of us. So what can you do to compensate for the lack of zone knowledge? Well, try to land in areas without any opponents. One way you can do this easily is by choosing unnamed locations. With the new map, we've observed an abundance of players landing at named locations, probably because they're still exploring and don't know just how good the unnamed spots are. Take this small island to the south, for example, aka Camp Cod. It's unnamed on the map, so many players just end up ignoring it. But can you guess how many chests it has? 17! 17 chests in a location many players are oblivious to. And with chests now spawning 100% of the time, you can get them all to yourself, as long as no one lands with you. Not only is there fantastic loot in this one spot, but also a great mix of materials, an upgrade bench, and a motorboat for when you need to rotate out. This spot is probably the most popular of the unnamed locations. But there are many others just like it all around the map, with plenty of loot and almost no enemies to deal with. While you may be eager to explore the new POIs, don't sleep on unnamed locations. The last mistake we keep seeing players make this season is not utilizing the fishing mechanic. Unless you're landing at Slurpee Swamps with all those sweet healing kegs, it's become much harder this season to walk out of your landing zone with 1 or 2 stacks of meds. Probably because chug splashes, slurp juices, and chug jugs can't be found anymore. But to help compensate with those being removed, Epic did add fishing, which everybody should be incorporating into their gameplay. When it comes to drop rates and looking for good fish, you really shouldn't be casting in normal water. Fishing spots have a much, much greater chance of giving you the loot you want. If you wanted a stack of small fries, that's when you'd fish in normal water. But a stack of floppers is almost better in every scenario. Maybe if you were desperate for HP or if you were looking for ammo, you could cast in still water. But other than those situations, it's typically better to find 1 or 2 fishing spots so you can get a stack of floppers real quick. To give you an idea of the catch percentages, a user on Reddit named FL4K the Critmaster did the work and grinded out a whopping 1,500 casts at fishing holes. You have about a 49% chance with each cast to find a flopper and an 18% chance to reel up a slurp fish. For weapons, you've got a 25% chance to pull out a blue weapon and a 7% chance for a purple and a 1% chance of getting a legendary. As the results show, you're going to be finding those fantastic healing fish 2/3 of the time if you cast in the hotspots. Not only that, but blue and purple weapons too. When it comes down to it, fishing to complete your loadout is a no-brainer. It only takes a few casts to get some really nice healing and a strong weapon or two if you're lucky. In comparison, fishing in normal water will get you a small fry about 50% of the time. Flopping and slurp fishes can still drop too, but the rates are so low you'll be much better off looking for a fishing spot to cast in. In their test, the Reddit user also found the mythic goldfish everyone has been talking about. Only once out of 1,500 casts. So no one's really seen much of this mythic goldfish since it's ridiculously rare. We're talking a less than 0.1% chance with those odds. But apparently, it's a throwable item that deals 200 damage if it hits a player, and can even destroy any structure it hits. Pretty cool, huh? I haven't seen one yet, but have you guys? Let me know in the comments if you have. Just one last tip to keep yourself protected while fishing. Fishing out in the open leaves you very vulnerable to flanks, but you can always build some cover to minimize that risk. A small 1x1 with an edited window for you to cast out of is all you need, and it'll stop players from flanking you and taking all your hard-earned fish. So yeah, definitely start fishing if you haven't been doing so. Anytime you're about to leave your landing spot with an incomplete stack of heals, consider grabbing a fishing rod instead so you can gather some of those OP fish. We know that there's a lot of change to adjust to in this season, but if you follow the tips in this video, we're sure that you'll start finding more success. Remember, give yourself ample time to rotate unless you want to risk getting into storm fights and missing out on endgame placement points. Stop using the weaker pumps if you found attack shoddy. Unless they get buffed soon, the gray, green, and blue pumps just aren't worth using. They're not completely useless, but attack outperforms them in pretty much every way. Start landing at more unnamed locations. A lot of them are perfectly viable even for squads, and you'll be less likely to run into opponents there. Don't be afraid to hop into playground and just explore around so you can learn them. And lastly, start fishing more. Slurp fish and the weapons you can find have some great drop rates as long as you cast in those fishing spots. Alright guys, that's it for today. We really hope you enjoyed this one. Comment down below what you thought and what you'd like to see next. We strive to bring you guys daily quality content, so do us a favor by liking this video, subscribing to the channel, and show ProGuys.com some love for bringing you this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. Again, it's your host, Dan. You can find me at Daniel Lammerman, and I will see you in the next one.